The Warrior's back for part 4. Debunking those myths and misconceptions about the Bible and slavery. Hit the music! Didn't even have to say anything. Let's give those guys a hand. They're pretty good. Well, I tell you, you guys are stressing out the Warrior's voice, having me doing all these videos debunking this crap. These guys would do some of the tiniest bit of research on their own, the Warrior wouldn't even have to be here. And of course, I guess they wouldn't be atheists because they wouldn't... and agnostics and deists, because they wouldn't have nothing to argue about. Let's get back to the facts, shall we? Now, when I left off in video 3, I was dealing with ancient Near Eastern slavery and showing the comparison, or the lack thereof, of ancient Near Eastern slavery, biblical slavery, and the roots, Kunta Kinte slavery, that we have in our minds so much when we hear the word slavery. Now, I've already debunked the idea that slavery is slavery. It's not, so far. And even in our modern day, you know, we have terms like love slave. See? Now, when you think of that, for some reason we don't think of roots Kunta Kinte because, you know, culturally speaking, that kind of slavery isn't necessarily a bad thing. In fact, the more I think about it, I understand how when the Bible speaks of the believers being slaves of God and servants of God, as opposed to slaves of sin and serving sin, it makes me think that what God is looking for in his people is love slaves. People who serve the Lord out of love for him. Even in the, you know, the Torah, for all you Jewish people out there, we have God saying, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, and all your soul. You see, and then your neighbor as yourself. So, yeah, love slave. Anyway, I digress. Getting back to the ancient Near East. Okay, we're going to read a little section here from the notes from the website, the Christian Think Tank. I believe it's .com. Let me check out my notes here. Yeah, I think it's .com or .org. But you'll find it. I'll put it in the, or is it over here? I'll put it in the more info section on the page so you can click on it and check it out. But it's not one of those websites that doesn't have documented sources. It's actually one of the most documented resources on the web. So, and I frequently check these sources. So, and I encourage you to do the same. So here we go. In the ancient Near East and Old Testament, this was not the case. Okay, and he's talking about the economic motive. Okay, in the roots Kunta Kinte slavery, the economic motive for the elites to make them money. Okay, but this wasn't so in the Bible times in ancient Near Eastern slavery. The dominant statistically motivation was economic relief of poverty. Okay, that is to say, slavery was initiated by the slave, not by the owner. Now, again, that's quite a different kind of slavery, wouldn't you say? For all you honest folk out there, you know, keep your mind open now. Don't close it up. Keep it open so we can see the facts here. Not the rhetoric from the folks, you know, that I have quoted in the, I put their links up in one of the, in my intro video. you know who they are. They know who they are. You know, the ones that don't give you resources and credible information to back up what they're saying, those people. Okay. Now, here we go. Okay, I'm going to read some more from the Christian think tank. The definitive work on A&E, or Ancient Near Eastern, law today is the two-volume work, History of Ancient Near Eastern Law. This work by 22 scholars surveys every legal document from the A&E by period and includes sections on slavery. Now, let's take a look at some of those sections right here. Very interesting section you really need to give a listen to. Okay, here we go. A person would either enter into slavery or be sold by a parent or relative. Persons sold their wives, grandchildren, brother with his wife and child, sister, sister-in-law, daughter-in-law, nephews, and niece. Many of the documents emphasize that the transaction is voluntary. Hear that? Voluntary. This applies not only to self-sale, but also to those who are the subject of sale, although their consent must sometimes have been fictional, as in the case of a nursing infant. Okay? And the reference is to page 1.665 in the book History of Ancient Near Eastern Law. Now, what's very interesting, once again, is that, and I have to admit, and you know, for our time today, for the modern times, we think, ew, that's disgusting, you know, selling your kids, your grandkids, your family, that's deplorable. Yes, by our modern standards, yes, it is. But, you know, we're not dealing with the morality of ancient Near Eastern slavery at this point, as opposed to our modern sensibilities. What we're doing is establishing that there is a difference between ancient Near Eastern and biblical slavery and roots kunta kinte slavery that we so often think about when we hear that word. We have to see a clear difference. You see, I've quoted you the Bible text, I've quoted you ancient Near Eastern history from an authoritative source. So now, let's get into the issue of, well, actually, let's get into that in video 5. And I'm not going to give you any of that atheistic, agnostic, skeptic Bible distortion jive in my videos. You're going to get credible facts that you can check out. And I'm out of here. See you in video 5. It's easy. Everybody's easy when I take them. I was lost so long. Never had anything called on. Till the Lord came down and set me free. Once I was blind, but now I see. He set me free.